Please turn with me in your Bibles then to the epistle of 1 Peter as we continue our verse-by-verse study through 1 Peter chapter 2, verses 18 through the first part of verse 21. I had to marvel this morning at the Lord's sovereignty and his providential control of all things as the topic in Sunday school went to our very topic of our sermon today. 1 Peter 2, 18 through 21a. Servants, be submissive to your masters with all fear, not only to the good and gentle, but also to the harsh. For this is commendable if because of conscience toward God, one endures grief, suffering wrongfully. For what credit is it if when you are beaten for your faults, you take it patiently? But when you do good and suffer, if you take it patiently, this is commendable before God. For to this you were called. Let's pray. Holy Spirit, truth divine, dawn upon this soul of mine, word of God and inward light. Wake my spirit, clear my sight. Dearly Father, we have read your holy word, your word of truth. I pray that your spirit of truth now would guide us into the truth and convict us, convict our minds, our hearts, and our wills. We ask this in Jesus' name, amen. In the first century, Peter was writing to persecuted saints in Pontus, Galatia, Cappadocia, Asia, and Bithynia, which is modern-day Turkey, covers an area of roughly 300,000 square miles. And these are saints who needed a word of encouragement to stay the course against oppression that they were being subjected to in the government, from the government, from the workplace, and their families that were non-believers. In chapter 2, verse 13 through 3:12, Peter testifies to the gospel in the social order, and he emphasizes it all in the theme of submission. Submission, sub under Mateo, the authority, to place oneself under the authority of another. And we have said in our culture that is not a popular topic today. I got my rights. I want things done my way. I want to do it my way. And yet we have in the Trinity, the economic Trinity, when Jesus, who was equal with the Father in their ontology, in all of their essence, and yet he submitted himself to the Father, came to this earth, took on human flesh, and went to a cross to die for the sins of us, his people. Equal with God, and yet he submitted himself to God. In no way does submission mean inferiority. Peter applied this theme of submission to the life of a believer as a citizen in chapter 2, 11 through 17, subject to a king and a government and market that the Caesar of the Roman Empire at that time that basically controlled the then known world was Nero. And he reigned from 54 to 68 A.D. And remember what he did to Christians? He blamed them for the burning of Rome in 64 A.D. He impaled them, put them in sackcloths, dipped the sackcloths in oil, and he lit the Christians, impaled them on the stakes, and used them as lanterns to light the streets of Rome. And now in chapter 2, 18 through 25, Peter addresses the believer's place in the workplace, specifically that of a servant subject to a master. In our day, we would say an employee subject to an employer. And here Peter commands that servants be obedient to their masters, and we apply this again to our day. Employees are to respect and obey their employers. The gospel in particular and God's word in general are relevant to the circumstances of Christians in our 21st century world only. And you and I ask ourselves the question today, are they relevant to our everyday circumstances? Can we relate at all in our relatively free society compared to the many restricted and hostile countries around the world to the gospel that is hostile to the gospel, Christ, and to Christians? And we should note that the words of Scripture include both a comfort and a warning at the same time. These words are a comfort to a believer amidst adverse circumstances in the workplace, and they're also a warning to anyone who violates or disdains to heed these words. In this context, the question arises, what is the Christian's place and purpose in the workaday world, in the workplace? What are to be his or her priorities? That question needs to be answered scripturally in a society such as ours that is so concerned with rights. I have my rights. America has more lawyers than any nation in the world. We listen on TV all the time to commercials. If you got this problem or this occurs in the workplace, please notify lawyer so-and-so, and he'll address your injustice, supposedly. There are suits against employers that are rampant. There's union regulations and worker grievances. This week I picked off my shelf Robert Bork's book, Slouching Toward Gomorrah. And in that book he talks about this emphasis on my rights and doing it my way. And he talks about the egalitarianism that is out there in modern liberalism today, the equality of outcomes rather than opportunities. And this of necessity presses a society toward tyranny and collectivism, because a powerful state is required then to suppress the difference that freedom produces. And at the same time in America, what we have going on with this radical egalitarianism that wants equality of outcome in spite of opportunities rather than opportunities, is that we have a radical individualism. A radical individualism then that wants to pursue everything in my way without restrictions. And he says these two do not juxtapose with each other, and yet modern liberalism in America has both of them together. So how do they jive? One is in the political arena, and the other one then is I go out and do my thing when it comes to seeking my pleasure and my recreation. I remember this mentality to me is so it's inoculated in us. It's inundated in us because our culture today is so oppressive. It is so ubiquitous around us in everything that we say and do. And I think many of us as Christians, we don't realize how much growing up in the American culture has impacted upon us and how we operate each day. The mentality of a lot of us when it comes to the workplace is that of John Rambo. In 1982, the blockbuster film came out, Rambo First Blood, starring Sylvester Stallone. And I must admit that I'm a guy and I like action movies, and I've seen that movie more times than I can count. But John Rambo is a decorated Vietnam War vet, and he wanders into this town in the upper northwest of the U.S., where he was mistreated by the local authorities because of his hair and his dress. And tension escalated to the point where Rambo then beat up his captors, several deputy sheriffs, and in his mind he flashed back this whole thing to his Viet Cong imprisonment. And he then escaped from these town sheriffs, and he armed himself with military weapons, and then with his Green Beret combat skills and know-how, he showed the full force of his anger and retaliation to the injustice that he had experienced. And when finally asked to turn himself in, he replied, what? He replied, they drew first blood. And for the tens of thousands of viewing audience, there was something satisfying about seeing a man exact revenge in the face of injustice. But friends, an inspired Peter did not write the Rambo script for you and I when it comes to injustice and persecution for saints in the workplace. Peter knew Deuteronomy 32:35. Justice is mine, I will repay, says the Lord. And Peter also concurred with Paul. And Paul wrote in Romans chapter 12, verses 17 through 21. Romans 12, chapter 17 through 21. Repay no one evil for evil. Have regard for good things in the sight of all men. If it be possible, as much as depends on you, live peaceably with all men. Beloved, do not avenge yourselves, but rather give place to wrath. For it is written, vengeance is mine, I will repay, says the Lord. Therefore, if your enemy is hungry, feed him. If he's thirsty, give him drink. For in so doing you will heap coals of fire on his head. Do not be overcome by evil, but overcome evil with good. And Peter, under the inspiration of the Holy Spirit and the theme of submission, tells us that enduring injustice in the workplace and resulting suffering may be part of one's calling in Christ. That the cost of suffering, then for the sake of the gospel, may indeed be part of our calling. Again, one needs to ask the question and answer it. What is my purpose as a Christian in the workplace? And what are my priorities before God and a watching world? May the Holy Spirit be our guide and our teacher as we have endeavor to learn to submit and not retaliate in the face of injustices that occur every day in varying degrees in the workaday world. May we heed Peter's inspired commands to the persecuted Christian slaves in his day in Pontus, Galatia, Cappadocia, Asia, and Bithynia. Do we evidence submission in the workaday world? The first point is, what is the mandate of submission? What is the mandate of submission? Verse 18. Servants, be submissive to your masters with all fear, not only to the good and gentle, but also to the harsh. The word here for servants is not the general term for servant or bondservant, doulos. The word here in the Greek is oikotai, and it's from oikos, which is house. So what we have here is household servants. The word is also found in Acts 10:7, when Cornelius called upon two of his household servants, his oikotai. And most of the servants in that day served in a household setting. And they served in all sorts of capacities. When you and I look at Galatians 4, 1 and 2, there it talks about a steward of a master who was in charge of the education of the master's son, who would be the future master of the entire estate. Also, we remember the movie Ben-Hur, where there was a steward there who was in charge of all financial matters of the Ben-Hur household. And those slaves were stewards over slaves, and they took care of everything then, from economic issues, financial matters, to education of children, to farm work, to household chores, to you name it. Out of the 120 million people that were in the ancient near world, 60 million or half of them were slaves. And so there were many of those that became Christians. The word for masters here is despotoi. We get the English word despot from it. It's the word that's also found in 1 Timothy 6, 1 and 2. When Peter says be submissive here, it's a present tense, ongoing, continual, and it's a passive participle, a passive participle. Slaves in the ancient Near East, they had no rights. They had no recourse in a court of law. They had no property rights. They were considered property rather than persons. And the masters had absolute control over them. Aristotle, in his Ethics, said this: a slave is a being who allows others to make decisions for him. A slave is a being who allows others to make decisions for him. And I'm going to digress from quoting Aristotle here to say this, is that you and I, born as human beings, are slaves. We are slaves. As Jesus said, he who commits sin is the bond slave of sin in John 8:34. And we know that we are born with a sin nature. So we are slaves to sin, the flesh, the world, and the devil. And then when we become Christians, when we are born again, we become slaves of God. A definition of a Christian is in Romans 6:22. And being made free from sin and become slaves to God, you have your fruit to holiness and the end to everlasting life. So the question for you and I here is, who are we slaves to? And we know it's only in Christ that we know the truth, and the truth shall make us free. And that freedom then is unto holiness, and it's unto glorying Christ. Aristotle continues in his Ethics. He said, a slave is a living tool, and a tool is an inanimate slave. A Roman nobleman named Varro asserted that the only thing that distinguished an animal or a cart from a slave is that the slave could talk. Peter said the submission of slaves was to be with all fear, with all fear. The NASB says respect, meaning without bitterness or animosity, but with gracious honor. Remember what Peter said in 1:17, honor all people, love the brotherhood, fear God, honor the king. We honor the king, and we know that it is under fearing God. We honor the employer as under fear of God. It's done always to evidence, first and foremost, our honoring God and fearing God. Then when you look at verse 18, to me, I wrote here, a comprehensive kicker. What's the kicker here? Not only to the good and gentle master, but also to the harsh. Not only to the good and gentle. The good is agathos. That's one who acts for our benefit. One acts in uprightness. One who acts in satisfactory ways toward his employees or slaves. The gentle one is one who is responsible in the Greek. One who is considerate. One who is fair. But he says, Peter also says here, to the harsh. Submit not only to the good and gentle, but also to the harsh. And the word in the King James is froward, but it's tois skolios. Tois skolios in the Greek. We get a back condition from this, scoliosis. You've got a curved spine. So it means crooked. Metaphorically, it means perverse. It means dishonest. So we are to submit not only to those who act for our benefit and satisfactorily, not only to those then that are gentle, they're reasonable, considerate, and fair, but also to those who are perverse, wicked, crooked. Christian servants, then, are to submit to masters, not only when it's easy, but also when it's the hardest thing to do. Not only when it's easy, but also when it's the hardest thing to do. Friends, the majority of the members of the Gentile church that Peter was writing to were slaves. They were slaves. Turn with me to Ephesians 6, verses 5 through 9. Ephesians 6, verses 5 through 9. Cross-reference for our text today. Ephesians 6, 5 through 9, Paul says, "Bondservants, be obedient to those who are your masters according to the flesh, with fear and trembling, in sincerity of heart, as to Christ, not with eye service as men pleasers, but as bondservants of Christ, doing the will of God from the heart, with good will doing service as to the Lord and not to men, knowing that whatever good anyone does, he will receive the same from the Lord, whether he's a slave or whether he is free." Christian employees are to submit to their employers in the workplace as if submitting to Christ himself. You and I ask the question, what are the positive God-honoring results? This precludes, friends, rebellion. This precludes strikes. This precludes subversive activity against the master or against the employer. You've probably heard in the news lately, it was interesting, that there's been a lockout by management of union longshoremen. So what the longshoremen have done is they've just disobeyed the court injunction against them to stay away from the docks. And what they've done is went in and destroyed a bunch of the employer's property. Because the owners, the management, want to go to non-union so they can save costs. And I ask myself, I wonder, are there any Christians, professing Christians, among those longshoremen? And I also, in my heart of hearts, ask myself, you've heard of Boeing that wants to go to South Carolina, which is a right-to-work state, and leave the state of Washington. And they've expanded their Boeing facilities in Washington and union employment there. And yet over the years, they've had so many work stoppages there that now they want to go to South Carolina. They built a new plant, employ 1,000 people, a right-to-work state. So it'll be non-union. And yet the National Labor Relations Board has refused them to do that, so they'll go to the Supreme Court. And I asked myself, maybe Boeing then should consider Christian employees who know 1 Peter 2:18 to prevent all work stoppages that they haven't, that the management has endured over the years. Remember, what's the mandate here? The mandate here is that Christian employees are to submit to their employers in the Lord, not only when it's easy, but under the harshest conditions that exist. 1:17, you honor all people, love the brotherhood, fear God, honor the king. Excuse me, that's 2:17. Honor all people, love the brotherhood, fear God, honor the king. We sang, how firm a foundation. Fear not, I am with thee. O be not dismayed, for I am thy God and will still give thee aid. I'll strengthen thee, help thee, cause thee to stand, upheld by my righteous, omnipotent hand. Do we evidence submission in the workaday world? The first point is, what is the mandate of submission? The second point is, what is the motivation of submission? The motivation of submission is found in verses 19 through the first part of verse 21. For this is commendable if because of conscience toward God, one endures grief, suffering wrongfully. For what credit is it if when you are beaten for your faults, you take it patiently? But when you do good and suffer, if you take it patiently, this is commendable before God. For to this you were called. Friends, the motivation for submission in the workplace is to first and foremost honor, fear God. And secondly, it's to point people to Christ. To point people to Christ. Christians are to live in the light of eternity and in the eternal perspective of things. It's of little regard in the workplace whether we get this promotion or not, or this salary or not, or whether we get this office location or not. What really matters in God's eyes is that we fear him and point others to Christ. Philippians 2, 14 through 16, do all things without complaining and disputing, that you may be blameless and pure, the sons of God without fault, in the midst of a crooked and perverse generation, among whom you shine as lights in the world, holding fast the word of life. Paul says that I may rejoice in the day of Christ, that I have not run in vain or labored in vain. You see there in verse 19, at the beginning of the verse, it says, for this is commendable. It means this finds favor or grace. And when believers do their work unto God in a humble and in submissive way, for their employers, especially for the sake of conscience toward God when enduring suffering, and that suffering can be physical or mental, this pleases God. I want to dwell a little on that phrase there in verse 19. For this is commendable if because of conscience toward God. Conscience toward God. Conscience, scientia, knowledge, plus con, with, held in common with another. Knowledge held in common with another, and of course for a Christian that means namely God. Knowledge held in common with God. John MacArthur says conscience is that God created self-judging faculty in man that either accuses him or excuses him. Thomas Aquinas defines conscience as man's judgment of himself according to God's judgment of him. And the Puritans, basically, they lived from 1550 to 1700, looked on the conscience as the mental organ in man through which God's word was to bear on them. Luther at the Diet of Worms, remember the reformers completed the work and extended the work of the Puritans. Luther, April 17, 1521 at the Diet of Worms. Behold, my conscience is captive to the word of God, and I cannot and will not recant anything, for to go against conscience is neither right nor safe. Here I stand, I can do no other, so help me God. And to the Puritans and Luther, the conscience signified a man's knowledge of himself as standing in the very presence of God. It meant that a man lived coram Deo, before the face of God, that conscience was God's monitor in the soul. Richard Siebes, who was another Puritan, pictured the conscience as God's court within us, where the last judgment is anticipated. He said this of conscience. First, it's a register. Conscience keeps a diary. Remember, men, when we went through on our Men of Grace, Bunyan's Holy War. Remember what the conscience was called in Mansoul, the city of Mansoul? Mr. Recorder. Mr. Recorder. Secondly, Sib says that the conscience not only is a register, but a witness as to what is or is not done. Thirdly, then, a conscience accuses or excuses. Thirdly, it accuses or excuses, which is Romans 2, 14 and 15. Fourthly, the conscience is a judge. Is it well done or is it ill done? And then fifthly, Sieb says the conscience is an executioner. Upon accusation and judgment, there is a punishment. And Sieb says this, the first punishment is within man before there is ever a hell. The first punishment is within man before there is ever a hell. The believer's main motivation in the workplace is to have a good conscience before God. And Paul in Acts 23:1 said he had a good conscience. In Acts 24:16, Paul says, I have a conscience without offense toward God and before man. And godliness to the Puritans was essentially a matter of conscience. It was to be maintained throughout life as a citizen or in the workplace by seeking to do God's will in all things and by keeping the cross in view. A person could do this, enduring grief or suffering, whatever, because God was in control of all things, and this world was not their home. They are par oikio. Remember, strangers, sojourners, foreigners, aliens, as Peter has said from the verse 1 of chapter 1. Look at verse 20. For what credit is it if you are beaten for your faults, you take it patiently? But when you do good and suffer, if you take it patiently, this is commendable before God. Peter states here a negative rhetorical question, and then he follows it with a positive statement. And the negative rhetorical question, you answer that with, of course, there's no credit. Believers who sin deserve chastening. That's Hebrews 12, 5 through 10. For whom the Lord loves, he chastens, scourges every son who he receives. They do it for themselves when they chasten us, the ungodly. But when God chastens us, he chastens us for our profit and that we might evidence holiness. And the positive statement is that those then who endured the physical or verbal abuse or even suffering because of their Christian beliefs, they would receive favor or grace from their Father, God, who was pleased. Now look at the beginning of verse 21. For to this you were called. Now here's the concluding climax. And the call there refers to an effectual calling, an irresistible grace. 1 Corinthians 1:9. God is faithful by whom we were called into the fellowship of his Son, Jesus Christ. Or 2 Timothy 1:9, who has saved us and called us with a holy calling, not according to our works, but according to his own purpose and grace, which was given us in Christ Jesus before the world began. God's purpose then for us, his children, as heavenly citizens in the workplace before a watching world is that you and I have a faithful testimony and we have spiritual integrity. And that may very well mean that you and I suffer in the workplace. 2 Timothy 3:12, all that will live godly in Christ Jesus will suffer. Philippians 1:29 and 30, for it is you, it has been granted on behalf of Christ not only to believe in him, but also to suffer, experiencing the same conflict which you see in me and now is in yourselves. And 1 Thessalonians 3:3, that you be not startled by these afflictions or shocked by these afflictions, for you yourselves know that we were appointed to this. In Acts 14:22, we must through many tribulations enter into the kingdom of God. Recently, there was a report from a mission field in West Africa where a Christian employee was subject to a very harsh treatment for 4 days. First from his employer and then from the government to renounce his faith in Christ. And he held firm, honored the Lord through all of that, and because of that, 4 of his fellow employees became Christians. 1 Samuel 3:20, God says, those who honor me, I will honor. And 2 Corinthians 4:6, a verse of new birth, For it is the God who commanded the light to shine out of darkness, who has shined in our hearts to give the light of the knowledge of God in the face of Jesus Christ. In Matthew 5:16, the aim of our obedience is to let our light so shine before men that they may see our good works and glorify our Father who is in heaven. Martin Lloyd-Jones says this, we are like the schoolboy who would like to evade certain things and run away from problems and tests. Before I complete that quote, just a little aside, I heard David Horowitz this week. And David Horowitz said that America is a free country, yet. And because America is a free country, they're a happy country. And because they're a happy country, they don't want to deal with facts and problems. After making that statement, he said he was a man, though, of hope. He was a man that was of positive assertion as far as America's future. Why? And he gave the statistic. He said, in World War II, there was a poll taken, and 80% of Americans, when World War II was raging on, did not want to partake in World War II. 80%. And yet, after Pearl Harbor, you know what happened when America awakened to the facts all around her. Martin Lloyd-Jones says, we're like the schoolboy. We like to evade certain things and run away from problems or tests. But we thank God because he has a larger interest in us and knows what is for our good. He puts us through the discipline of life. Many things that are trials for us are essential that one day we may be found to be without spot or wrinkle. When through fiery trials thy pathway shall lie, my grace all sufficient shall be thy supply. The flame shall not hurt thee, I only designed thy dross to remove and thy gold to refine. The soul that on Jesus still leans for repose, I will not forsake to its foes. That soul though all hell shall endeavor to shake, I'll never, no never, no never forsake. His purposes will ripen fast, unfolding every hour. The bud may have a bitter taste, but sweet will be the flower. Do we evidence submission in the workaday world? We've looked at 2 points this morning. What is the mandate of submission? The mandate of submission for Christians is that you and I are to submit to the employer not only when it's easy, but even under the harshest conditions. And what is the motivation of submission? It's twofold. To fear God and honor him first and foremost. And secondly, to point people to Christ. Friends, as opposed to the world of Rambo and his response to the injustice in the workplace and its resulting suffering, there's the example in Scripture of David in dealing with King Saul. You remember in 1 Samuel 18 and 19, where David ended up in Saul's court, and this evil spirit from God came upon Saul. And when Saul heard, after they had conquered the Philistines, that Saul has killed his thousands, but the women were chanting, David had killed his 10,000s, that Saul was angry, and he made that statement, what's left for David but to have the kingdom? And so when the evil spirit of God came upon Saul and David was playing on his harp for Saul, he took that spirit and tried to pin David to the wall. Well, he missed. That's chapter 18. Chapter 19, he tried the second time to pin David to the wall and David fled. We get 1 Samuel chapter 24, verses 2 through 12. If you would turn there, please, with me. 1 Samuel chapter 24, verses 2 through 12. 1 Samuel 24, verses 2 through 12. Then Saul took 3,000 chosen men from all Israel, and he went to seek David and his men on the rocks of the wild goats. So he came to the sheepfolds by the road where there was a cave. Saul went in to attend to his needs, and David and his men were staying in the recesses of the cave. And then the men of David said to him, this is the day in which the Lord said to you, behold, I will deliver your enemy into your hand, that you may do to him as seems good to you. And David arose and secretly cut off the corner of Saul's robe. Now it came to pass afterward that David's heart troubled him, because he had cut Saul's robe. And he said to his men, the Lord forbid that I should do this thing to my master, the Lord's anointed, to stretch out my hand against him. seeing his anointed of the Lord. So David restrained his servants with these words, did not allow them to rise against Saul, and Saul got up from the cave and went on his way. David also arose afterward, and he went out of the cave, and he called out to Saul, saying, "My lord, the king." When Saul looked behind him, David stooped with his face to the ground and bowed down. David said to Saul, "Why do you listen to the words of men who say, 'Indeed, David seeks your harm'? Look, this day your eyes have seen that the Lord delivered you today into my hand in the cave, and someone urged me to kill you, but my eye spared you. And I said, 'I will not stretch out my hand against my Lord, for he's the Lord's anointed. Moreover, my father, see, you see the corner of your robe in my hand, for in that I cut off the corner of your robe and did not kill you. No one see that there is neither evil nor rebellion in my hand, for I have not sinned against you. Yet you hunt my life to take it. Let the Lord judge between you and me, and let the Lord avenge me on you, but my hand shall not be against you." And then turn with me to chapter 26. Chapter 26, verses 6 through 12. Chapter 26 of 1 Samuel, verses 6 through 12. Then David answered and said to Ahimelech the Hittite and to Abishai the son of Zeruiah, brother of Joab, saying, "Who will go down with me to Saul in the camp?" And Abishai said, "I will go down with you." So David and Abishai came to the people by night, and there Saul lay sleeping within the camp with his spear stuck in the ground by his head. And Abner and all the people lay all around him. Then Abishai said to David, "God has delivered your enemy into your hand this day. Now therefore, please let me strike him at once with the spear right to the earth, and I will not have to strike him a second time." But David said to Abishai, "Do not destroy him, for who can stretch out his hand against the Lord's anointed and be guiltless?" David said furthermore, "As the Lord lives, the Lord shall strike him, or his day shall come to die, or he shall go out to battle and perish. The Lord forbid that I should stretch out my hand against the Lord's anointed, but please take now the spear and the jug of water that are by his head and let us go." So David took the spear and the jug of water by Saul's head, and they got away, and no man saw or knew it or awoke, for they were asleep because a deep sleep from the Lord had fallen on him. Friends, in the face of Saul's hostility against him, even Saul's desire to kill him, what did David do? He rested in God's promises to him that one day he would be king over Israel. Therefore, David did not need to assert his rights or take vengeance against Saul. It's important that we as Christians remember that when we are God's children, we become the enemies of the world. Romans 8:7, the carnal mind is at enmity against God, and we could add against those who are in God or in Christ. In John 15, 18 through 20, Jesus said, "If the world hates you, you know that it hated me before it hated you. If you were of the world would love its own. But because you are not of the world, and I've chosen you out of the world, therefore the world hates you. Remember what I said to you, the servant is not above his master. If they persecuted me, they will persecute you also. If they receive my words, they will receive yours also." And you and I, because we're God's children, we will incur the hostility in the workplace. But what is our calling in Christ? What is to be our calling in Christ? 1 Corinthians 10:31, whether we eat or drink or whatever we do, we are to glorify God. In Isaiah 43:7, we know that we are formed, we are created for God's glory. 1 Corinthians 6:19 and 20, what? "Know ye not that your body is the temple of the Holy Spirit, which is in you, which you have of God, and you are not your own? So you are bought with a price. Therefore glorify God in your body and your spirit, which are God's." Friends, no matter what, we're to be faithful to our calling, exhibiting integrity in the workplace, to be the best employee that we can be. Colossians 3:23, whatever you do, do it heartily as to the Lord and not to men. Ephesians 6:6, we're not to be men pleasers, but to work to please God and to do all things in Christ and to Christ's glory. So we are to fear God, honor him, and point people to Christ. Remember chapter 2, verse 12. "Having your conduct honorable among the Gentiles, that when they speak evil against you as evildoers, they may, by your good works which they observe, glorify God in the day of visitation." Those oppressors who oppress you because they are ungodly, you are godly, they are observing you in the workaday world. And as they observe you, by your good works, then how you respond, whether it's to the gentle, the beneficial, or whether it's to the harsh. They are observing you. And through that oppression, then the Spirit of God works and leads them to saving faith of Christ in the day of their visitation or salvation. Remember, as Christians, we're to submit in the Lord to those who are in authority over us in government and in the workplace, not only when it's easy, but also even under the harshest of conditions. Hebrews 13:14. We have no continuing city, but we seek one to come. 1 Peter 4:12-14. Beloved, think it not strange concerning the fiery trial which is to try you, as though some strange thing happened unto you, but rejoice, inasmuch as you are partakers of Christ's suffering, that when his glory may be revealed, you also may be glad with exceeding joy. If you are reproached for the name of Christ, blessed are you, for the Spirit of glory and of God rests on you. On their part he is blasphemed, but on your part he is glorified. And you and I are faithful to Christ in the workplace, so that one day we will hear Matthew 25:21 from the lips of our Lord. Well done, thou good and faithful servant. You've been faithful over a few things. I will make you ruler over many things. Let's pray. Dear Heavenly Father, we just thank you and praise you for your word of truth. How relevant it is to our day. We who are Christians living in a post-Christian society that is going to wax worse and worse until Christ comes. I pray, dear Heavenly Father, that we would heed the mandate and the motivation of submission that the inspired Peter wrote in 1 Peter, that we would submit to those in authority over us, not only when it's easy, but under the harshest conditions, that we would do so in the Lord, and that we would do so, our motivation would be fear and honor of God, and secondly, to point others to Christ, so that in the day of visitation, we may indeed also rejoice that we have endured the oppression in the workplace that you used, sovereignly used, to point